countries come to the IMF because they've been living beyond their means. One way or another, they've run out of money, and typically they've run out of ways to borrow money to keep living beyond their means. When that day of reckoning hits, or if they're clever, they come well before it hits, but they see it coming, two things have to happen. One is you have to stop living beyond your means and start living within your means. The other typically is you've been living beyond your means because you've been borrowing money. Well, at the same time you have to start living within your means, you also have to figure out how you're going to start repaying what you borrowed.
What we have had in Suriname is an income shock. And an income shock van de ergste soort die je ooit kan hebben. De inkomsten van de overheid die dropten dramatisch naar 10-15% van wat het was. Erger nog, deze inkomensshock werd gecombineerd in een verkiezingscyclus. We praten over de zwaarste klappen. We begonnen mid 2014 naar 2015 te gaan. En op dat moment zijn de verkiezingen aan het voorbereiden. In principe heb je hebt geen coalitie, je hebt geen echte regering. Men is in het veld bezig. Dus wat je kan doen is zo snel als mogelijk aanpakken zodra er een stabiele regering gevormd is. En dat is dus ook gebeurd. 12 augustus kwam de nieuwe regering aan bod. En per 13 augustus zijn er zeer zware maatregelen genomen.
When was the IMF first approached by the Surinamese government for help?
We were here for the annual report discussions, right, in September. And then we were talking about how the things are getting more and more challenging. And basically, I would say in December, you know, that's when really the idea that we need, there was the request for financial support, because we always provide technical assistance, various advice, but the idea of the financial support, that was around December.
Is het zo dat het parlement niet is geconsulteerd, het parlement dus achteraf geïnformeerd wordt over een deal die eigenlijk al beklonken is?
Eén, het is nergens vastgelegd dat het in zegen met het IMF eerst door de DNA moet worden goedgekeurd. Er is altijd consultatie met de DNA geweest. Mijn speeches hebben zich altijd daarop gericht. De precaire situatie is binnen de DNA behandeld. En er is ook aangegeven toen wij de discussie met het IMF begonnen, dat we discussies zijn begonnen. Dus het was geen geheim.
A lot of people in Suriname got the feeling that now IMF is going to rule Suriname, that the government doesn't have the power they used to have. Maybe you can explain it a little bit more, how it's going to work and if the people have to be afraid or not.
We have the macroeconomic framework. We check that everything that the authorities are planning to do adds up to delivering on these goals. But it is their measures. It was things that were already going to be done in Suriname. So basically this gives them a coherent framework, and then three-monthly deadlines, essentially, every 3 months. So we'll be back in August to review performance of the program, and then every 3 months that everything is staying on track. And we carefully check the numbers. You know, we basically audit the numbers so that it's really... But the ownership is here in Suriname.
Programs work because governments want them to work. And if there's real ownership and a desire to make the program work, the program can work.
By the end of the program, by 2018, the reserves of Suriname should be equal to about $850 million, roughly where Suriname was some time ago. So that is in 2018. And then the question is, when does the repayment start? And the repayment starts in 2019, and it lasts for 5 years, so by 2023. So it basically gets paid over 5 years. And some more details on that are in, if I can refer you to table 6 in the report. So it's all on the internet, and you can see exactly the timing when the loan gets paid off, and it starts in 2019.